Active Health Radio is delighted to be sponsored by The Really Healthy Company. www.healthy.co.uk.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to peoplesinternetradio.com. My name is Ben Lowry, and I'm guest hosting tonight. This spot is usually the Fiona Shakila Burns show, and backtohealthevents.com is her website, and she's focused on health and healing, and she's a really impressive woman. I know a lot of the listeners that are listening to the show are already familiar with her story. She lives in Bristol, so do I, and so we know each other quite well. I've interviewed her before. She's got an amazing story of healing herself from cancer, and in fact, if you go on YouTube, there's an interview with me and her where she tells that whole story, just in case, you know, people want to go and catch up on that. Really crazy, and the insane frustrating thing is it's actually illegal to talk about curing diseases like that. There's a Cancer Act, I can't remember what year it is, 1952, something like that, prohibits people from claiming to be able to cure cancer. Which is extremely frustrating, because I know that a lot of the listeners that listen into this show are very alternative-minded, think about the root causes of things, the lifestyle, the nutrition, the emotional, the spiritual reasons for disease in the body. But it's very difficult to promote things like that, because there's the risk of getting arrested and locked in a cage, insane as it sounds. But anyway, I've got some really good guests for you this evening. And I'm also going to talk a little bit about my own story, because I've had my own journey with health and nutrition, and got total alopecia a couple of years ago in 2012. All my hair fell out randomly for no particular reason, you know, that I can figure out. I'm going to tell you about that. But the first guest we've got up in a minute is Laura Wilson, and she has just had a new book published with Hay House Publishing, big publishers, so it's a great achievement to get a book published with them, and it's called The Alkaline 5 Diet. She's going to be telling us about that. She's a nutritionist and ultramarathon runner, and so we're going to hear about her story. Then after Laura, next awesome guest, Nathan Lloyd Hewitt. And Nathan, I avoided Nathan for a long time because he's a way better guitarist than me. And, you know, he can play really fast. I could never really play very fast. I kind of, I just kind of settled for, you know, kind of playing the rock blues style because I could never really get my fingers to go that fast. But Nathan can do the whole thing, and he's been a professional guitarist the same as me. I know some of you know me. You know my backstory. You know, I used to be a guitarist when I was younger. I started an online guitar lesson website and, had some success for that. So, and the third guest, yeah, we're going to hear from Nathan. Oh, by the way, he lost 10 stone of body fat. Incredible. When he was 15, I think, he was at his heaviest, if I remember correctly. He was, it was over 20 stone. I think it was 23 stone or something like that. And he managed to lose 10 stone of body fat by the time he was 18 or 19 or 20. And now he's very well recognized. He wrote a book called Try This Book for Size, which helps people lose weight. And he's a really positive, inspirational kind of guy, and we're going to hear from him shortly. And then last, we've got Muscle Man, 80s action hero. I'm joking. Jada Castellari is going to talk to us about body transformation in terms of physique, in terms of fitness, in terms of fat loss, in terms of muscle, and things like that. So a great lineup of guests. And I want to thank Vin for having me on the show, too. I got to know Vin several years ago when I was interested in the free man on the land and the sovereignty movement, which examines, you know, our individual rights as individuals versus, you know, the government. And, Vin's known me from back then when I was going through my whole journey of trying to rebel against the government, and as many of us were. And it didn't work out too well for me. I ended up losing my driving license. And going bankrupt, actually, trying to A for V a tax bill, which some of you will know what that means. Some of you will know what I'm referring to. So it's been a bit of a journey. And I was never particularly interested in health when I was younger. You know, I was never really sporty. When I was at school, I was playing guitar. I never was interested in being on the football team or the rugby team or anything like that. And I thought that some people just have six packs and some people don't. As crazy as that sounds, I actually believed that. I thought it was just genetic or something, you know, everyone's got a metabolism. I had a friend called Joe, and he always had a six-pack. He's one of those people that's really lean, you know, he could eat anything. He never put on any body fat. He always had a six-pack. And it was a mystery to me. Like, how does that happen? How come I've got a belly? How come this guy's got a six-pack? We've got the same lifestyle. We eat the same thing. And it's just kind of annoying, especially, you know, when you're a young man and you kind of all the forces of nature are acting on you. You want to look cool. You want to impress the chicks. And it was just a mystery. And I just figured, oh, well, some people have six packs, some people don't. And it was only till late, you know, my late 20s, like I mentioned already, the alopecia came on. My hair fell out for no apparent reason. And I looked into nutritional reasons that could have been the cause for it. You know, I spent a lot of time on the internet. You know, there was a lot of theories that said it's related to the digestion. Some theories suggested it was a deficiency of vitamin B, and it could be to do with particles getting through the digestive system into the blood and then the body overreacting to fight off the particles, you know, with its immune system, and then overreacting and kill it in the hair follicles as well. That was one theory. And I did a lot of juice fasting. I did a sort of 10-day green juice cleanse. That was a couple of years ago, around about the start of 2013. And I always like to try and make the most of things. Like, if I'm going to do something like that, I'm really into social media, internet, promoting things online. So when I was doing the green juice cleanse, I didn't just do it. I filmed video diary of it, and I got interview guests onto Skype, and you know, made a little YouTube show out of it where I was interviewing these health experts about green juice and the benefits of cleansing. Anyway, despite, you know, a relative amount of cleansing and cleaning up my diet, the hair didn't grow back. So I kind of gave up on that eventually. And I'm lucky because I kind of get away with it. I look all right. I kind of look like I chose to be bold. You know, I've got my head's a reasonably nice shape, and I don't look too unusual, really, being bold. But I think it's probably more, it would be a much more difficult thing for women to deal with, I think, you know, for obvious reasons. You know, women don't typically shave their head, so it does look more unusual on a woman. But, you know, I had it relatively easy, really. It didn't really impact me emotionally or psychologically very much. And what happened was, I decided I was going to use it as a positive. And, you know, I felt like I looked a bit strange because all of a sudden, having no eyebrows, no eyelashes, you know, you look like, I kind of felt like I looked seriously ill. You know, I look as if I've got cancer. I look as if I've been on chemotherapy. I look as if I'm about to die. And so I kind of became very self-conscious of how I looked. And I think it increased my desire to want to look healthy. And it caused this natural desire in me to want to go to the gym, to want to exercise, to want to get in shape, to want to show the world and women that I was healthy. And so that's what kind of happened. I started going to the gym, started getting in shape, started lifting weights, started enjoying it. It took a while. You know, it took 6 months to really get into it, but I started really getting into it. And of course, as is the case with anything, as you start seeing results come in, then you get more and more interested in it. You know, you start seeing the body fat reducing on your body, and all of a sudden, for the first time ever, you can see abs coming through, and you can see pecs and muscles, and hold on a second, I kind of like this. And so I think, you know, once you can get to that point, past that first hurdle, once you start seeing those results, I think then people generally tend to stick to it as a way of life. Then, you know, you could say it's addictive, in that sense. But you know, this exercise and weightlifting and general healthy lifestyles become part of my lifestyles, become part of my identity. I'm a shy kind of guy, so I like posting lots of pictures of my body on Facebook. And, you know, and I've created a bit of an identity as a bit of a kind of fitness kind of guy, fitness model. And it's great. You know, done loads of resources. You're going to hear from Jada later about the bodybuilding and the fat loss. So let's get our first guest up. So Laura Wilson, you there, Laura?
I'm here, Ben. Yep. Hello.
Thanks for joining us on the call tonight. And why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself, Laura? What do you do? What's the background? Tell us.
Okay, so I'm Laura Wilson. I live in Devon, down by the sea, southern UK. And I'm a nutritionist, a natural health nutritionist, specifically in the area of an alkaline and vegan diet. I've been researching nutrition and health and fitness for about 15 years. And it was kind of born out of a similar-ish desire as you, Ben. I had like a bit of a health crisis, and that just really made me want to research and find out, well, okay, I'm in this state of health. To be more specific about it, when I was at university as a student, I woke up one morning after a very heavy night out the night before with my student friends in halls of residence, and I had this rash all over my legs, and it was just the most itchy rash. And I was like, oh no, what is this? I wanted to just ignore it, but it was that itchy that I had to go to the doctor. So I went to the doctor. He took one look at it and said, oh, well, that's alcohol poisoning. Don't worry about that. I was like, what do you mean that's alcohol poisoning? Isn't that what alcoholics get? And he's like, well, you know, a lot of students get it. And he tried to pass it off. Obviously, he sees this a lot, so it was kind of nothing to him. But to me, it really hit me. I was like, this is really bad. Here I am. I'm 19 years old. And it was kind of like the culmination of a year of living, you know, smoking lots, drinking lots. In the halls of residence that I was living, we were catered. So morning and evening, we'd have like a big fry up breakfast. And then in the evening, something equally stodgy, meat-based, heavy. So after like a year of this, I just felt tired and lethargic all of the time. And I just thought that's the way it is. A lot of my friends looked and felt the same. So I just saw that as being normal. However, when this doctor said to me, you've got alcohol poisoning, I just kept thinking to myself, what would my mum and dad think of this? This is really quite outrageous and it's not acceptable. So then and there, made a decision that I need to get fit, I need to get healthy. So stopped going out partying with my friends as much, joined a gym. I was living in Birmingham, in like a real rough area of Birmingham, Handsworth, for anyone who knows that area, it's like real rough. So I joined this gym, it's like a real spit and sawdust gym, went in there, little white girl me, with these huge, big black men, and just really felt totally out of my comfort zone, but thought I need to just get fit. So got myself on the treadmill. I remember the first mile I ran, it took me like 12 or 13 minutes and I actually felt as if my lungs were going to explode. It was so difficult, but I felt good afterwards. So I was like, right, I need to keep this up. So just two or three times a week would go to the gym, and then each time I'd run for a little bit longer and try and do it a little bit quicker. And after a while, just really got bitten by that bug. So really cut down on my smoking, cut down on my drinking, and was now fully into getting fit. So I left university, came home, and just began researching a lot. In my job, I worked in a university for a few years, and there was little bits of time where I could go on the internet in my lunch break or whatever and just research, well, what dietary changes can I make? What's going to improve my running? Because that was my main motivation. I wanted to improve my running. And there was a lady in my gym, the new gym I joined when I moved back to Plymouth, and she said, look, you do all this running, why don't you do the half marathon? You've got like 6 months to train, so why don't you do it? And I just thought, no way, a half marathon, that's 13 miles. I'm running like 4 or 5 or 6. But she, bless her, she was really persistent. She said, Laura, you'd be great at it. Just do the training. I'll give you a plan. Put yourself in for it. So I did. And I ran that first half marathon, and it was one of the most difficult things I've ever done. But again, I loved it. I really got into it. I liked the adrenaline. I liked that ache afterwards, the kind of real ache you get from working hard at fitness. From there, just eventually cut out the smoking and was naturally on a fruit and veg based diet. And I just found that was working wonders in my own life. So that was kind of like my path onto fitness, if you like. And then fast forward, you know, like 10, 15 years now, and I'm fully into the alkaline diet. And I run a website as well. And I've helped 15,000 odd people around the world through my recipe books and videos talking about the alkaline diet and the benefits to make some dietary and health changes for the better.
Laura, I'm going to start off straight away with a challenging question. I think many of the listeners might have heard about the alkaline philosophy of eating, and we'll get into more of the details in a minute. But I interviewed a guy, Paul Jaminet, a couple of weeks ago before you. Now, he was advocating a high-fat diet. He was saying about 50% fat, and he was saying 30 to 35% carbs and about 15% protein. And he's the author of a book called The Perfect Diet. Now, that's a very difficult balance of macronutrients to the 80-10-10, which is more in line with your philosophy, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now, this is really confusing to me because, you know, we're hearing complete different nutritional philosophies with complete different ratios of fats and carbs. What would you say is wrong with the fat philosophy?
Well, that's obviously one of the troubles with, you know, with diet advice. A lot of it is conflicting. 50% fat is just way too much, and the evidence shows that from many different research studies. So number one, the China study, which is still the largest nutritional study on human health that's ever been conducted, categorically shows that a plant-based diet, so high in carbs, is the best for health. I'm in contact with a doctor called Dr. Neil Barnard. In fact, he's written the foreword to my book. And he has had massive research funding from the NIH, the National Institute of Health, for his study, which was rolled out in the area of diabetes, and it showed, and this is real new stuff, it's only been around for like 10 years, this knowledge, that diabetes, type 2 diabetes, is actually not a problem of high carbohydrate, it's a problem of too much fat in the diet. And yeah, that's been categorically shown. But also, obviously, things like heart disease is all about clogging up the arteries with what? With fat, typically animal fat. Now, some people would say, well, you know, you want to be getting good fats from things like flaxseed oil, coconut oil, olive oil even. But I know personally, and from speaking to many other people out there, specifically vegans, because a lot of people, when if they go vegan, they go on to kind of like a gourmet vegan diet, which is very high fat. And the results that you see in these people are just the same time and time again, which is low energy. And typically people think they're detoxing because they're eating like raw and an alkaline and fruit and veg based. They think they're doing really good by their health. But if it's too high fat, then they're fitness and energy levels go through the floor. So what I would say is, and I don't know this doctor's background, but is he an athlete? Because there's no way an athlete, someone who's fit and able to have a lot of endurance, now whether that's running or whether that's working a long day and, you know, looking after kids and running around doing all sorts of different things, it's going to be, I would argue that you can't have any kind of level of great endurance on a high fat diet. It's just not the way we're designed.
What about the type of fats that we've heard are good, you know, coconut oil, avocado, the type of fats that are in nuts? Are they all right for you?
Well, yes, but in moderation. There's really no need to add, especially refined oils, to our diet. It's unnatural to take olives, say, which are, you know, it's just a vegetable. There's not a massive amount of fat in it, or vegetable oil, or even flaxseed. And to compress that to get the oil out of it, it's a refining process, just like a refined sugar. So sugars in fruits, you know, oranges, apples, pears, grapes, whatever, is good. But as soon as you distill that down and refine it, then it becomes too concentrated, and fat is really, it's really the same. And we get more than enough fat. The optimum ratio of fat in our diet is between 10 and 15%. And that's been proven by people like Dr. Douglas Graham, Dr. John McDougall, Caldwell Esselstyn, Dr. Neil Barnard, who are all systematically reversing disease and creating great health with their patients with a diet which is low in fat, so around about 10% fat.
Okay, so let's just clarify your philosophy. I heard you mention the 80-10-10. So is that the same ratios that you advocate for people?
Yeah, pretty much. My diet, the Alkaline 5 diet, is pretty much 80-10-10. So as I mentioned, a guy called Dr. Douglas Graham wrote this book after a long period of research in, I think it was the late 90s. And yeah, he advocates the optimum macronutrient ratio is 80% carbohydrates, 10% fat, and 10% protein. And that is completely in line with the World Health Organization. They say that 10% protein is more than enough. And in fact, the problem in our society is not too little protein or too little fat. It's an excess of both of those things. That's where degenerative disease from. Degenerative disease is not caused by high carbohydrates. It's caused by high fat, high protein.
I see. Now, when you say carbs, I mean, refined sugar is carbs, fruit and vegetables are carbs, pasta and potatoes are carbs. So what kind of carbs are you talking about for ideal health?
Okay, so that's where the alkaline aspect comes in. And I'll just kind of give a brief overview of what it means to have an alkaline diet for anyone who doesn't know. So our body's blood needs to be maintained at a slightly alkaline pH. So on the acid alkaline scale, which you probably learned at school in biology, 0 is highly acidic, 14 is highly alkaline. And our body's blood is around about like 7.35. So very, very slightly alkaline. And that's a non-negotiable. If that deviates, we die. So your body will do everything it can to keep your blood at that set point.
So, Laura, let me interrupt you. Sorry to interrupt. I just got to get this little gripe, not with you, with other people I'm talking to. When I was talking about the alkaline diet to some people, they think that if you eat alkaline food, it's going to like change the pH of your body, of your blood. But that's not the philosophy, is it? The philosophy is your body must maintain that precise pH balance. And either you're going to help it do that by putting the alkaline food in as opposed to the acidic sort of Western diet kind of thing, or the body's going to find another way of doing it, which is to steal minerals and nutrients from the reserves in the bones and stuff like that.
That's exactly it.
So that's the point, isn't it? It's not like we're raising the pH of the blood. That's not going to happen.
No, it's working in harmony. It's just working with what your body needs. When, like I say, that set point is non-negotiable. So you can do one of two things. You can either say, right, what are alkaline foods? Alkaline foods, or alkaline forming food, should I say. For example, a lemon is an alkaline forming food. The net result of being metabolized through your body by a lemon is you get an alkaline mineral ash at the other end.
I've heard that, but why is that?
It's just the residue of the minerals, which your body can then assimilate. And conversely, something like milk in its physical form is alkaline, but when it goes through the body and your body has to break down things and try and deal with the casein, which we're not supposed to be digesting, which is for cows, then it is acidifying. So we can do one of two things. We can either say, this is what my body wants. It wants alkaline forming food, so that's what I'm going to give it. Just like when you've got a car putting in high octane fuel, the car will perform well. So our bodies go, thank you very much. I know exactly what to do with that. It'll assimilate it easily. And you can get on with your life with energy, with health, with vigor, and with a leanness and a vibrancy about you. Or you can say, well, you know what? I like having a few beers at the weekend. And I like having a burger once a week. And yeah, I like the odd curry here and there, and I'm not doing too bad, you know. Vegetables, I have them every few days or so. We can take that kind of attitude, and then our bodies go, what are we going to do with this lot then? Right, we're going to try and extract the minerals and vitamins we can, but there's not going to be that many. So in the absence of what we like the amount we need, we're going to take, like you say, maybe calcium from our bones and compromise other functions in the body to still maintain that set point of the blood. So in doing that, that's when you'll experience lower energy, probably things like skin breakouts. And then eventually over the longer term, things like, you know, the big three diseases, obesity, cancer, heart disease, diabetes, things like that, or even other things like psoriasis or athlete's foot. So, but the problem of illness and degenerative disease is really one thing, which is over acidification of the body.
Yeah, perfectly clear. Tell me what you think of this. I know this is not the only approach to understanding your body's health, but I really like the idea of paying attention to how things make you feel. You know, if I eat something, does it make me feel more energized or more lethargic? Do you think that's a good way to go? Some people say that, you know, just pay attention. Some people say everybody's body is different. People's bodies respond to different foods in different way. You know, it's different for everyone. You just got to pay attention to how you feel. Is that a good approach, do you think?
I don't know on that one, because in one way it sounds nice, it sounds good, but it's kind of like saying, you know, just spend money, and if you feel good spending money, then spend it. If not, then don't. But I don't think it's that easy, to be honest. I don't think most of us are disciplined enough or in tune enough to be able to do that. Most people in our society have some kind of eating disorder, whether it's just emotional eating when they're feeling a bit down, or in which case, so how do you distinguish that? If you're feeling a bit upset, and you know, probably this is the case for women more than men, but you know, you might be feeling a bit emotional, so you have a tub of ice cream or half a tub of ice cream, and in the moment you feel better, but then maybe a week later you feel bad. Would you associate it with that ice cream? So I think we're on dodgy ground if we start going by our feelings with things. I think there needs to be a base level of just objective science in here, and going with what has been proven, not by just your fluctuating day-to-day feelings, but actually on what's worked longer term over, you know, a massive group of people.
Yeah, that makes sense. Otherwise, there's no limits and no boundaries. You can just say, yeah, oh, well, I feel good eating chocolate. So,
yeah. I mean, you know, there are people out there who say, yeah, I just eat when I'm hungry. I stop before I'm full, and I'm guided by my body. Well, God bless those people, because I think they're few and far between who actually do that in a really kind of responsible way. But if you can do it, that's good. But I would still say having that objective kind of input is important as well.
One of the things that this guy Paul Jaminet was advocating was intermittent fasting, which basically I think that means kind of not eating too late at night, going through the night with no food obviously, and then eating kind of midday rather than first thing. So it's like 12 or 16 hours of fasting, and he said that was really important for the body to regenerate and rest. And what do you think of that?
Well, I agree with him on that. In fact, I've done a 7-day water fast before, so I had nothing but water for 7 days. That was real tough, but I did get some good benefits. I felt it was like being on some weird drug. After about 3-4 days, my hunger kind of went up and down, but what I did find is my senses became so attuned, like my hearing became really, really clear, my eyesight, and I did feel this real rejuvenation after the 7 days. Now, I know that's not specifically what he's talking about, but that, yeah, I do think that was beneficial for me, and there's been lots of other people who can attest to a kind of prolonged period of fasting. But in terms of fasting maybe like once or twice a week and not eating until lunchtime, yeah, definitely. In fact, I'm doing a fast at the moment. I'm about 24 days through a 40-day fast, so I'm only eating between 2 PM and 6 PM. That's actually a spiritual fast. I'm doing the Daniel fast, which a lot of Christians do this time of year. But yeah, I've seen some really good health benefits. It's just good to give your body that break, to let your organs kick out a load of rubbish. And also kind of mentally as well, to force yourself to not think about food, because it's such a massive part of our lives, isn't it? It's, you know, I love to eat, and without having any boundaries in place, I'm always thinking about food. Oh, it's only an hour till lunch. Oh, it's only, you know, I'll have a snack in half an hour. So it's good as a kind of discipline to force me to say food isn't the be all and end all, Laura. Think about other stuff as well.
Mm-hmm. So we're kind of limited on time with this show because we've got two other guests. Tell us what we can expect from this book that's going to be released in April, The Alkaline 5 Diet. I'm sure you must be really excited about it, are you?
Yeah, I am. Yeah, it's basically been kind of 15 years in the writing, and it's taken like two years to come to publication. So yes, and I'm excited about it because it's called The Alkaline 5 Diet, and you basically eat 5 meals a day. And I created this book because other alkaline diet books out there make it very hard and very kind of unsustainable. If you're just eating vegetables, which a lot of alkaline experts advocate, you're going to fall off the wagon at some point because it's totally unsustainable. With my diet, there's a lot of fruits. There's a lot of, you eat big. So if you like eating pasta and rice and potatoes, this is like the perfect diet for you, because I guarantee your cravings for junk food will just go. Because when you're carved up, then you know what it's like. If you have a massive meal, do you feel like eating chocolate afterwards? Usually not. So this is like, I call it the five S's. This diet is simple. Basically, most meals you can make in under 10 minutes, and that includes cooked meals as well. It's totally satisfying. You know, like I say, eating comfort foods like pasta, rice, it's really filling, really nourishing. Sustainable, you can do this diet. There's a 21-day meal plan at the end of this book, but you could do it for 21 days or 21 years. It's not some fad diet that you might get short-term weight loss, but then after that, you're going to fall off and it's not going to work. You can do this over the long term because it's super healthy. And it's systematized with the five meals. You know that you have like your vitamin vitality meal, which is a fruit-based meal. You've got your hearty cooked fiber meal. So it's a combo between some raw, some cooked. So you're getting a real spectrum of alkaline minerals. You're working in that harmony with your body. And it's a really great way to eat big, but still lose weight. And the reason for that is because it actually turns off your fat genes. Dr. Neil Barnard, and this is a whole different subject, you might want to look into this another time, but Dr. Neil Barnard found that when you eat high carbohydrate, low fat, low protein, it actually turns off your body's fat genes. Your body isn't very efficient at turning carbs to fat. So eat high carb and you'll get lean.
Laura, tell us about the websites where we can follow you. You've got a couple of blogs, a couple of websites. What are they?
Yep. My main website that I'm using now is laurawilsononline.com. And I've just finished creating a brand new guide called The 7 Ways to Alkalize Your Body. So as well as eating, then there's specifically 7 other ways that are really going to help your body for alkalization. And the benefits of that is that you're going to have just better better skin, better vitality, better energy. If you're looking to get rid of a disease or a kind of niggling health issue, this will help you. So for example, deep breathing exercises is great for alkalizing your body. So yeah, my 7-point guide is free on laurawilsononline.com.
What's deep breathing got to do with alkalinity?
Well, because deep breathing oxygenates your body, and basically our cells need to be kept at this alkaline pH, and oxygen is highly alkaline. So when you oxygenate your cells, it naturally alkalizes it.
Oh, I see. So even cardiovascular exercise, like even just going for a run, is going to assist in the alkalinity, supporting the body that way, is it?
Yes, as long as you don't do too much. As soon as you get into doing like hours and hours of cardio, then it tends to have a detrimental effect on in terms of acid alkalinity. But yeah, moderate cardio is fantastically alkalizing.
Okay, Laura. So thanks ever so much for being a guest on this show. It's been great having you on. The book is available for pre-order on Amazon, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. Yeah.
You can search the Alkaline 5 Diet. Just call out your website one more time just to remind us.
It's laurawilsononline.com. Or if you go to alkaline5diet.com, then there's a video explaining it and talks about the book there as well. Yeah.
So. All right then, Laura. Well, thanks for coming on the show. It's been great. Thanks for your time. I'm sure the listeners really enjoyed that.
Thanks, Ben. You're welcome. Bye-bye.
You're welcome. Bye-bye. All right, everybody. That was really good. And, you know, it's such a short amount of time to talk about a vast amount of detail, as you can tell. We were just really skimming the surface on a few of the key questions that were coming to my mind. I first started learning about the alkalinity concept when I went to Tony Robbins seminars. Tony Robbins is a motivational speaker, an American guy. I know the listeners on this show are pretty aware of all that kind of thing, but you know, motivational, inspirational speaker. He does big seminars all over the world. I used to go to London, and I remember when I was 17, my mum got me interested in personal development topics. She got me The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey, which is a classic. I know many of you will have heard of that. And that kind of piqued my interest. And then I was sitting watching the telly at night, and these Tony Robbins adverts were coming on, the extended advert. They call it an infomercial. And he was promoting his tape set or CD set, whatever it was. And it's quite expensive, you know, it's about 100 quid or something like that. It's quite a lot of money. And I'd seen this advert a few times, and I said to my mum, because she was interested in this type of thing, and it was all about how to improve your life, you know, every aspect of your life, your health, your wealth, your emotions, your business, your relationships, the whole thing. He seemed like a pretty genuine guy. And so I struck a deal with my mum. We went 50-50 on the cost of it. And yeah, guys, mute your microphone if you can. Thanks. Yeah, we went 50-50. So I got these CDs, and it's fantastic. Love the guy. Brilliant. You know, I'm pretty open-minded. I'm not too skeptical. I'm usually willing to listen to that kind of thing. And it was great. And then I started looking around for other people that were interested in these topics. And I found a networking group in Bristol called Yes Group. And I started going to Yes Group. It was like a monthly meeting, and they'd have guest speakers come along and talk about all different aspects of life, you know, so, you know, business, health, wealth, everything. Really good. And there was a London one, there was a Cardiff one, and they started popping up all over the world then. There's Yes Groups everywhere. You could probably find them in your city. Great place to – great way to meet similar like-minded, open-minded people, you know. That's one of the benefits of those networking things, is you start to develop a peer group of like-minded people. Because, you've heard the saying, you become who you spend time with. If you spend time with fit, healthy, happy, successful people that have got great relationships, you know, it's going to rub off, because their mindset, their philosophy is going to have an impact on you. If you hang around with a bunch of wasters that are, you know, sitting around doing nothing and, you know, eating pizza and smoking, it's eventually going to creep its way into your lifestyle. So, you know, it's worth bearing that in mind. Now, our next couple of guests, we got Nathan Lloyd Hewitt up next, international weight loss coach. Nate, is it fair to call it a media storm? Is that a good characterization of what happened last year?
Yeah, well, I guess you could call it that. Yeah, it came as a shock. It was quite a surprise. And it just took off.
So I'll just give a quick introduction. You can tell your story. So at the age of 15, was it? Is that when you were your heaviest?
Yeah. Well, at the age of 14, I was weighing 23 stone.
Incredible. And then by the time you were 18 or 19?
Well, it took me about 18 months to lose all the weight. So when I got to about the age of 16, 17, I got down to a normal size.
Yeah, right. And you lost 10 stone of body fat. That's 140 pounds. That's a heck of a lot of weight. Now, since then, you've become a recognized figure. You've got a website. You've got a book. Try This Book for Size. The website is trythisforsize.com. And last year, I don't know what happened, but all the newspapers in the world, it seemed, have picked up on your story, because it is a great story. You know, you lost a lot of fat. It is an inspirational story. So tell us about the last kind of couple of years, you know, what's been going on with your journey.
Okay. Well, of course, I mean, I've always had this, I think, after losing so much weight, I came inspired. I was inspired to, I guess, help other people to, you know, obviously to get them to have the same experience that I've had. Because, you know, my background of being an obese child and an obese teenager, I was very low. You know, my self-esteem was on the floor. You know, I had very little friends. You know, I seemed to be emotionally, you know, down. And I guess I never thought to myself that I would ever lose weight or amount to anything in life. So it was quite, you know, it's quite strange being a weight loss coach today, considering I come from a background of being completely, you know, distraught with my weight. So I guess that's inspired me to, you know, show people what's possible, that you can, you know, lose weight, and that you can achieve, you know, amazing results with your body.
Nate, if people say that it's just genetic and, you know, there's not much you can do about it, some people are destined to be slim and skinny, some people are destined to be overweight, is it true? Is there a genetic aspect to it or not?
Well, I always say this, Ben. I don't think anyone is so special that they could survive on a desert island without food. Right. Because the fact is, you would lose weight. If you didn't have any food on a desert island, you would have to lose weight. There's no doubt about that, because your biology would allow it. You know, fat loss is biology. you know, forget about genetics. There's no such thing as someone. If you don't eat any calories, you're going to lose weight. As simple as that. And it's quite funny to, you know, that people come from this myopic viewpoint that it's genetics or nothing, because it's completely false.
Right. Nate, I want to just jump in with some technical questions straight away, because something that I've heard people say is about the thyroid. And if you've got issues or the thyroid is not working correctly, that can have knock-on effects on the metabolism. It can cause the body to store body fat. What's your viewpoint on that?
I guess my attitude is simply comes down to calories. I mean, of course, I know that certain macronutrients can affect your, you know, metabolic rate. I mean, of course, someone who is, you know, constantly shoveling sugar and carbohydrates is going to have, you know, a different metabolism. It's going to affect it in some way. But I honestly believe that it all comes down to calories, because, you, like I said before earlier, there's no such thing as someone who could survive on a desert island without, the fact is... You're going to burn body fat and lose muscle weight as a result of not having any calories. I really believe that, you know, no one's so special enough to use a genetic disadvantage or a thyroid problem as an excuse. I believe we're all capable of burning body fat no matter what, no matter your circumstances, no matter your genetic makeup, because biology, which is something we all share, the same biology, you know, it's possible. We can lose body fat. That's for certain. There's no excuse big enough, in my opinion.
Right, yeah, got it. Now, I'm kind of jumping back and forwards with the questions a little bit here, but you're in the process of organising a tour around Wales, doing workshops where people can come and learn from you. So what's the latest news with that? How's it going?
Well, at the moment, I'm currently building a resource booklet, because these classes are going to last for about 6 to 7 hours. So I've been, you know, developing content that's going to last for that time. So I've been rather busy for the last 8 weeks, and I've been building this, you know, booklet, and I've got to get everything designed and organized. So it's still a process, but it's one that's, you know, coming along, you know, good. And hopefully within the next 4 weeks, within the next month, I should be ready to hold these events, which I'm very looking forward to.
Excellent. That's great, Nate. And you consult with people and help people on a one-to-one basis with their... Yes. Weight loss and fat loss. So maybe you could give us some examples of people you've worked with or some good success stories that will be inspirational for us.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I focus on, you know, extreme cases. I mean, I look for people who have had, you know, long-lasting weight problems, who have kind of spent, you know, many years of their life suffering with weight. Now, I can take one guy as an example, which I may have mentioned to you before, Ben, that was weighing over 35 stone. Now, of course, I won't mention any names, but what I can tell you is that, you know, this was quite common amongst obese individuals, is that they have this belief that they cannot lose weight, despite no matter what they do, they have this belief that weight loss is impossible. Now, as a coach, it's my job to, you know, change that person's beliefs, to show them what's possible and that, you know, their biology can allow fat loss to occur. And it's about, you know, creating those new beliefs, which I know you're aware with, Ben. And it's also creating a new identity, an identity that, you know, revolves around nutrition, you know, and good foods and good health and, you know, taking up exercise. Because if there's one thing I find in my life, Ben, that's different, is the fact that I've built myself an identity on nutrition and health. You know, it's something that I enjoy. It's who I am on a personal level. You'll never see me acting in ways that would cause me to become obese, because it's just not part of my identity anymore. So, you know, as a job as a coach, it's my job to actually, I guess, help people build that identity, you know, redesign their life, redesign themselves as a new person.
Right, so you really focus on the psychological aspect to it.
Absolutely.
Which is, that's something, yeah, a lot of people don't really think about, do they? Like, you know, everybody knows that if they eat more salad and less pizza, they're going to lose, yeah, weight. But that's not the sticking point, is it? The sticking point, like you just said, is in the way they feel about themselves, what they believe is possible for themselves and what they want for themselves.
That's it, yes, Ben. And a lot of people, which is quite common, they are not in tune with their own emotions. I think a lot of people kind of, I guess, are brought up and, you know, they kind of drift through life without fully understanding themselves on a personal level. I think for, you know, a lot of people do kind of, you know, drift away and they never really, you know, make conscious decisions about what they want from life. And I try to help people develop their emotional intelligence as well, to show them that they can, you know, make new decisions and, you know, can overcome, you know, these issues that they have with themselves. You know, I find it really bizarre, you know, now being, you know, 11 and a half stone, I find it bizarre, you know, to think that I was the kind of person who wasn't in tune with himself. I literally was, you know, emotionally distraught. I didn't have any sense of identity. I used to drift through every single day not knowing who I was. And I find that's quite common among obese individuals. They don't know who they are. They don't realize that, you know, we are people, we're animals, and we have this consciousness, and we can take charge, we can take control, we can make new decisions, we can change our life. The possibilities are endless. And I don't want to sound, you know, too over the top and, you know, kind of one of these gurus type, but, that's the truth.
Yeah, and transforming your body and improving your body, it's not just about vanity. It's not just about I think some people have an idea of it that it's just a shallow wanting to look a certain way. But the bottom line is, if you improve your body, if you lose some body fat, if you get in shape, you're going to feel so much better about yourself, and every area of life is going to improve. You know, the way people respond to you. I noticed this just when I, over the last couple of years, you know my story. I wasn't overweight, but I was just an average looking guy, nothing in particular, you know, and I got in shape. I put on a little bit of muscle. I looked like a workout, and people respond so differently, so more positively. It's incredible, the difference.
Yeah, absolutely. At the end of the day, it is a knock-on effect. The way I see it is, if someone's, you know, in the gym, if someone's looking after their health and is taking care of their diet and, you know, making conscious decisions for their health, you know, it's very unlikely that you're going to, you know, become this type of person who's going to start neglecting other things in your life. It's going to have a knock-on effect. You're going to take an interest in other things as well. I found that when I lost weight, I started reading books. I started taking up more, you know, study. I wanted to learn more. You know, there's just a complete knock-on effect that happens with people when they start to really look after themselves, and take those aspects into consideration.
Yeah, tell us about the future. What's coming up for you? I know you've got the tour coming out. You're working on the workbook, like you said. But what do you see for the long term for your goals, Nate?
Well, the long term for me, Ben, I mean, for some people, this might sound unrealistic, but I don't believe that. I believe that, you know, anything's possible. I've shown that I've been able to create, you know, amazing changes in my life. But I really would like to take these workshops further, because currently, there's no workshop in Wales to do with weight loss. Now, if you want to learn about business, you'd go to a business workshop. You know, there's various workshops you can go to, you know, learn about things. But when it comes to weight loss and health, where do you turn to? Because, you know, it doesn't exist. So I want to be like the first person to bring these workshops into my own country and build on that, you know, and create, you know, a buzz and get people come in. And I'd like to take it further across the country, you know, and come over to England as well, you know, work in the UK and do that. But eventually I'd like to take it into other countries. I mean, in the future, in the next 5 years, this could be something really big. I mean, I've always been inspired by Tony Robbins events like you, Ben. You know, I love Tony Robbins. He's an inspiration to me. And, you know, his workshops, his events seem to, you know, work around everything, you know, every area of life. But what if I could create an event that would focus solely on weight loss for obese individuals? Somewhere that everyone could come together and really, you know, study this in depth, really take charge of their life and really start making goals for their health. You know, where does that exist in the world? It doesn't. And that's what I'm working on. And I'm currently developing this booklet and this program that I believe is going to work.
I feel completely certain that you're going to end up an international touring all over the world, you know, TV shows, radio shows, nonstop for the rest of your life. I can really see that coming. You know, I don't know whether it's going to happen in the next 6 months or 12 months or 2 years, but it's inevitable, I think, don't you?
Oh, thank you, Ben. I appreciate that.
Yeah, well, also, you know, tell we've got an international audience, and you've got resources available on your website. So tell us the website and what's available for them to go and get right now.
Okay, well, my website is called trythisforsize.com. And it's currently a blog, you know, with other various resources, like I offer coaching via Skype, like we are. But the blog, I share information based on my experience. you know, like I mentioned before, I'm someone who has had a weight problem. I'm someone who's been obese, and I've felt those emotions. And I know what it's like to feel like, you know, change is impossible. So when I write something at my blog, it comes from, you know, personal experience. And I think that's a very valuable resource. And it's free. That's the great thing about it. And I really urge anyone to click on that site. If they have a weight problem, check out my blog. Because I share everything from my past up until now. And, you know, and that stuff is free, and that's great. But of course, I also have my downloadable ebooks, which are, again, based on my experience and study, which is available to people. But my site is currently undergoing, it's having a bit of a revamp. It's going to be updated, and it's going to have new features, because it's going to feature these workshops where people can sign up online, you know, and be invited with a new coaching letter as well. So that's in progress as well. So whilst the website's up and running, it's going to be something completely different within the next, you know, few weeks.
Just stay on the line, will you, Nate? We're going to take a break. We're going to have a music break, hear a song, and we'll be back in a few minutes. There's a bit of an echo going on. You might have to turn those speakers down. Thanks for listening, everybody. We're going to be back with another guest just in a minute, Jada Castellari. We're also going to finish up speaking to Nate, and see you after the break. Bye for now.
Back to Health Radio is delighted to be sponsored by The Really Healthy Company. Suppliers of the leading natural immunomodulator, green and organic superfoods, and ultra-absorbable functional nutrients. Visit www.healthy.co.uk.
Welcome back, everybody. This is Ben Lowry, and you're listening to peoplesinternetradio.com. This is the Back to Health show, which is usually hosted by Fiona Shaquila Burns, and I'm a guest host today. She's away with her father. They've gone away for a long holiday. I hope she's having a good time. She might even be listening in. I don't know. Hi, Fiona. And I was with her, actually, while she was broadcasting her January show. And she had some great guests on. There was a guy from Glastonbury who was very knowledgeable about marijuana, hemp oil. I don't really know much about it, so I'm struggling to find the words, but he really knew his stuff. And as far as I'm aware, all the shows are archived on the website, so if people go to peoplesinternetradio.com, then you can go to the back issues of the show and check that out. And we're currently on the line with Nathan Lloyd Hewitt. You still there, Nate? Is Nathan still there? I don't know, he might have muted himself or something. I'm sure he'll be back on in a second. And we got Jada Castellari coming up. Looking forward to that. We're going to talk about – what I love about all these three guests is they're all holistically minded. And that's why, you know, I'm associated with them. That's why I invited them to come on the show. You know, they don't just look at, you know, the individual treating the symptoms kind of thing. These are people that think about the whole lifestyle, the whole spiritual, emotional, psychological, you know, health and physique and the way it all – because it all affects the other, right? And so that's why I chose these guests to come on the show. It's amazing how many people don't think in that way, though. You there now, Nate?
I don't know where he's gone.
Can he hear me? I'm not sure. We might have to get Jada up if Nate's not around. You there, Jada? Don't panic. I can ramble. I can ramble for a little bit longer.
Hello.
Hello, Jada. Jada's on the line. How you doing?
Hello, mate. All right. Yeah, very well, thank you. And you?
Yeah, good, thanks. I better introduce you.
Okay, go on, Em.
Yeah, all right. We'll pretend we haven't started yet. So, Jada Castellari, you're a body transformation specialist. That's how you tend to refer to yourself, is that right?
Yes, that's it. Just a transformation coach, which is basically the art of transforming somebody's body, helping them lose body fat, build muscle, and basically give them the body that pretty much everybody wants.
Yeah, I was just telling our audience that the reason I chose yourself and Nathan and Laura as guests tonight is because you're all, and me as well, we're all holistically minded. You know, we don't just think about trying to deal with one area of our health. We view it as a whole lifestyle, the whole emotional health, you know, and everything. And what's your view on that when it comes to body transformation?
It really is, like you said, it is holistic. You cannot go through a physical transformation without going through a psychological, emotional and spiritual transformation at the same time. And anybody that has transformed their body to a high degree like that would admit the same thing as well. In fact, I asked one of the country's highest paid transformation coaches this very same question. You know, do you see your clients go through the same emotional transformation, spiritual, psychological transformation when they go through a change? And he said every single time, without fail. And the more of a physical change that people go through, the more of an internal change they go through as well. So absolutely, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, great. Jada, I don't know if you've got your headset plugged in at the moment, have you?
Yes, can you hear me okay, or is it a bit...
Yeah, it's all right. No, it's all right. I was just checking because it sounds there's some room ambience, but it doesn't matter. Jada, you were in my dream last night.
Okay.
So I had a dream. You were having a party at your place, and it was loads of girls. It was loads of chicks everywhere.
That sounds pretty cool, man.
Yeah, it sounds pretty normal. And I was confused. I couldn't figure out who was with who. And I these girls were hitting on me. It was a good dream. They were hitting on me. But I wasn't sure. I was like really reserved because I didn't know whether this girl was with you or she was with this other guy. And I was sort of a bit paranoid because I didn't want to do anything. Anyway, that was what happened in the dream. Cool. I don't know if you want to psychoanalyze that, do you?
I don't know. I guess dreams make up for what we want in real life sometimes, maybe.
Yeah, maybe. Now, you've had a busy day. You've been training with people all day, yeah?
Yeah, I've literally not long just got back in.
Right, okay. Tell us about what a typical day for you, you know, in the gym. What do you do with the clients in the gym? What's your training style?
Well, the most important thing for me to bear in mind is that everybody's a complete unique individual. So everybody's on a different place on their transformational journey, and everybody has completely different and unique needs. And a lot of the time with clients, I actually kind of like use a lot of what would be termed intuition. So when a client turns up, the first thing I do is I ask them how they are, but I take a good look at them, and I can kind of feel where they are. Okay, so for instance, if you've had a really brilliant day and you come into the gym and you're ready to train with me, then we can get straight into it. If you've had a bad day, then I might have to spend a few minutes with you, kind of getting you focused and kind of like getting your mindset on what we're doing and where we're going. Obviously, other things to take into consideration with clients is where they are with their diet, where they are with their motivation, where they are with their beliefs. And then where they are with their individual training needs. So it's just such a unique bespoke thing for each client.
Oh, I see. So it's not just a case of getting on the weights and doing some bench pressing. It's more than just that.
Oh yeah, far more. Yeah. It's very, very bespoke.
Right. You do Skype consultations for international people that can't get to you. You know, some people come to the gym, but people can go to jadacastellari.com and email Jada if they want to arrange a Skype consultation. Now, give us an example. Let's imagine a case study. Somebody came to you and they said, you know, I want to improve my body. I want to get in shape. I want to put on some muscle. What's the first line of inquiry you would begin with them?
It all depends on where they are, what their experience is. I mean, if they're a complete novice, I mean, the first place I direct everyone to is my website, because there's a lot of real basic information on there. There's like the basics of how to build muscle and lose fat, etc. But I mean, someone came up to me today and they said, they asked me about body fat, and the question was, how do I lose this bit of fat around my stomach? So my instant reply was, well, you can't spot reduce fat. You have to lose fat all over. And then they started asking me a few more questions about fat loss. And I just turned around and said, look, if you really want to know about fat loss so that you understand it, so that you can apply it, I said, I can talk on that subject for days. It's not something that you can give somebody a 5-minute answer to.
Mm. Yeah. I see. Right. So the first thing people can do is go to the website and read the free information that you've got.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, when it comes to someone having a desire to change your body, you've got to remember, especially this time of year, there's a lot of people have got the idea in their head, oh, it'd be nice to lose some fat and put on some muscle and change the shape of my body and kind of go down that route. That would be a nice New Year's resolution. But what percentage of people actually end up following through and doing it. It's a very small percentage. So with most people, the best place to start is really with the psychology. So if you do want to transform your body, you've got to kind of dig into the real reasons why you want to do that. And you need to kind of focus on those reasons, and you need to attach those reasons to the rest of your life. This comes back down to something called, you've heard of John DeMartini, haven't you?
Yeah.
Well, he talks about values are a driving force, okay? So, for example, for the listeners, some people really value friendship. So if you look at those types of people who really value friendship, it doesn't matter what happens in their life, they will always, always make time for their friends. Some people really value their family. So whenever they, whatever spare money they have, they immediately spend on their family. So our values are our unconscious kind of like motivating or driving forces. So if somebody's not trained before and they've not really been eating healthy, then clearly their value for being healthy, their value for training, and their value for that lifestyle is very low. Does that make sense? So the first thing they have to really do is they have to start to raise that as a value in their life, so that their motivating forces, their unconscious mechanisms for doing what they do, actually get into alignment with what they consciously desire.
Yeah. That makes sense. You do a process with people to kind of to focus on what their unconscious desires are, and to.
Well, yeah, I always work with desires with clients, because it doesn't. You know, you can have a desire for something, but you can increase that desire. You can like turn up the volume, and obviously, if you really increase the desire for somebody for something, then the will to achieve that, the will to do that, to get that, actually increases too. So the likelihood of getting it increases. So desire is not something that I kind of like do with a client and then forget about. It's something that I'm always poking and increasing and driving in the client.
Oh, I see. So this is like a life coaching sort of psychology type of thing. So if you get people to decide what they want, and then you increase the desire through
yes.
it, through psychological
yes.
techniques.
Yes. Yeah.
I know you do hypnosis and stuff like that.
Yeah. There's many, many different techniques. I mean, the real simple thing to do for people right now, if they're listening and they've got an idea that they want to get healthier, lose weight, build muscle, change their body, but they know that it hasn't really been a value before, is the easiest thing to do is to look at your life and to have a good look and find out what your existing values are. Okay, so you look at your life and think, well, what do I spend most of my money on? What do I spend most of my time thinking about, talking about, reading about? What magazines do I buy? What books do I buy? And this will start to give you a clue as to what your values are. So say somebody's got a value of, say, business and making money. Okay, mm-hmm. and then they've worked out, hang about, I read a lot of business books and listen to it, and I enjoy making money. Okay, that's definitely a value that is already high in their life. Then what you need to do is you need to start to really build the picture of how that will improve when you become healthier, when you become more muscular, when you become more testosterone charged, when you become more vibrant, when you become a higher vibrational person. So then you can start to link a low value, getting in health, getting healthy, getting fit, getting lean, getting muscular, with a value that's already high in your life. And you start to connect them together. So you start to build a picture. You start to build a future with your existing high values with the new added value. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does make sense. So let's say, for example, I've got I'm a businessman. I've got a high value on money and career. Well, if you link up in my mind that if I improve my health, my body, lose some body fat, then that's going to help my career, help me make more money, then this is going to get linked up, yeah?
Absolutely. And it's really easy to do. I mean, business is a great one, because people that do well in business have had to develop some kind of strategy, some kind of mindset. They've had to put in hard work. They've had to assess where they are, assess where they're going, look for feedback. So applying that kind of business mindset to training kind of adapts quite well. And I found it very easy to get business-minded people to adapt to a lifestyle where they improve their body to the point of building muscle, getting leaner, getting healthier. Because when you actually change your body, you're changing your chemistry. Okay, and at a basic level, we're a bag of chemistry. That's what we are as humans. We're producing brain chemistry. We're producing neural peptides. We're producing hormones. All these things are gently and fluctuating moment by moment in our body. So when we start to get healthier and we start to build muscle and we start to change our bodies change. Our chemistry changes, and by default, our thinking cannot help but change.
Yeah.
And if you think about it, take a fat person that's seriously overweight, like the guy was saying earlier, when he was overweight, he didn't have any self-identity, he didn't know who he was, he didn't have any purpose, didn't have any drive. Now you change that to somebody who's lean, who's muscular, who feels powerful on a daily basis. I can guarantee you they've got purpose, they've got a direction, they've got something worth living for.
Yeah, there's no way it cannot have knock-on effects on the rest of your life, is what you're saying.
Definitely not. I mean, at the end of the day, our body has its own consciousness. Okay, I call it body-mind consciousness. I mean, there's thousands of examples of this in transplant patients, where a patient will have a transplant of some sort, and shortly afterwards, they will start to develop personality traits of the donor. So, like, you might have an ordinary person that's never had a desire to go rock climbing before, and after a transplant operation, all of a sudden, they can't get rock climbing out of their head. Later to find out that the transplant donor was a rock climber. So this shows us that the mind is not just stored in the brain, as most people think, but the body actually encompasses our emotions and our thoughts as well.
Yeah, it's really interesting, isn't it? Oh, I remember Tyler Tolman saying to me about, you know, a lot of New Agers talk about the chakras and all that, and it's like a swirling vortex of energy.
Yeah.
We got an open-minded audience, they're used to all this.
Good.
And Tyler said something which seemed so obvious after he said it. He said the chakras represent the endocrine glands.
Yes. They're all related, yes.
All down the body. And when they're functioning correctly and in harmony, what have you, then that's what they represent, the body being in perfect health with all the hormones working correctly.
Yeah, definitely. Well, I can speak from experience. Obviously, I've been through my own sort of changes physically, and I can definitely tell you that when I'm what I call in a peak state physically, which is where my body's working at its optimum level, I recover quicker, I stay leaner easier, I build muscle easier, and that's all down to being emotionally in the right place and health-wise as well. Sorry, I've completely lost my thought.
Yeah, don't worry. I could pick up, or I could ask you the next question. It's up to you.
Somebody just popped in the room, and I just completely lost my thought. Go on.
No, I can't remember what I asked you. I'll go on to the next question.
Go on then.
Yeah, I was going to ask you to tell us your backstory. Like, how did your body, why did you get into fitness, exercise, weightlifting?
Why did I get into it? Yeah. Well, this is another interesting thing as well. I mean, I got into training when I was a teenager, and for about 3 or 4 years, I did press-ups, sit-ups, chin-ups, had my dumbbells. And for about 3 or 4 years, I did basic training, and I looked okay, but I certainly didn't look like a bodybuilder or like the way I wanted to look. And it wasn't until I met somebody when I was about 19 who actually was already where I wanted to be that taught me the basics of what I needed to know. But what he actually did for me was give me belief. And although he taught me the basics of what I needed to know, the most important thing he gave me was the pure belief that I too could do it. But going back, my reasons for wanting to build muscle back then and get bigger and stronger were kind of very different to what they are today. Because what a lot of people can do with weight training is they can take negative emotions, and you find this a lot, and they put it into training. So somebody may have had a violent childhood, and you'll get this a lot. Sometimes people who have had violent childhoods sometimes go into martial arts, or they go into weightlifting, and they channel that aggression into something so that it becomes a positive. But after time and years of doing that, they get to a point and they think, well, I haven't got any of that aggression left anymore. What's my motivation for doing this now? So over time, motivations for training and doing that kind of thing can change.
Yeah. See what you mean? Jada, we got a question come up from a listener.
Okay, cool. Go on in.
What if a 40-something-year-old man is considering this transformation? Are there any considerations one should adopt?
Yeah, well, this is an interesting one because straight away from the nature of the question, I can tell that the person is concerned whether he's too old to start training, or whether it's worth starting training, or whether there's going to be any complications at starting at that age. Now, the interesting thing is that they've done studies on age and weight training, and this is in the Deepak Chopra book, Ageless Body, Timeless Mind, and he cites this study where they've got a group of 90-year-old people and 90 and above, and they put them through a weight training program and a high protein diet, etc., and straight away every single one of them started to build muscle at the age of 90.
Right.
So when it comes to building muscle and sort of reversing your health, if the older you are, the more of a reason there should be for starting to look into this lifestyle. Because as far as I'm concerned, as far as I've seen, it really is kind of the elixir to youth.
Right. Is that because of the hormones that weightlifting produces, like testosterone?
It is, but it's because of the healthy eating. You have to eat foods that nourish your body, and if you're going to do it correctly, you don't just eat to build muscle. You eat to keep your organs healthy. You have to be fully hydrated with water, with clean water. You have to also, like you said, you have to eat and supplement to make sure that your hormones stay optimal. So your muscular system is also part of your endocrine system. It's also part of your immune system as well. Every time you go down the gym and you pump weights, you're pumping your lymphatic fluid around your body, so you're helping your body detox.
You know, bodybuilding for some people has kind of got a negative association. They just think of, you know, big sort of gorilla guys lifting weights. And that is something that a lot of people don't really want to do because they don't want to be that kind of person. And it's a shame, really, because it's not really necessarily like that, is it?
Definitely not. I mean, this is what I said to somebody today. You've got mainstream bodybuilding has actually almost gone underground because it's taken something and it's taken to the extreme. People taking steroids, eating ridiculous amounts of food, building their bodies to be the biggest they possibly can. Now, respect to them for their individuality and what they want to do, I don't knock it at all. But the kind of lifestyle that I promote or bodybuilding that I promote is more of a natural-looking physique, more of a mainstream-type-looking physique, somebody that's lean, muscular, healthy-looking. The people that I attract aren't people that want to be wanting to be the most monstrous person on the planet. They're just wanting to look, they just want to develop the aesthetically pleasing physique that everyone aspires to.
Right, yeah. So just because you're lifting weights in the gym or doing bodybuilding style of exercise doesn't mean you're going to end up a muscle monster, gorilla, meathead thing.
Well, not being funny, it's bloody hard work trying to build muscle. So anyone that can just go into the gym and just chuck a few weights around and accidentally grow really big, they're yet to be discovered.
Yeah, that's not going to happen. There's no danger of it happening, is there?
There's no danger of that. There's no danger of that happening. Definitely not.
The reality is, if people go in and do weightlifting style exercise, like you said, they're going to look healthy, they're going to look lean, they're going to look a bit toned, they're going to feel good about themselves. That's basically all that's going to happen. You know, they're not going to turn into a monster.
No, but going through the process of learning to train, learning to eat properly, learning to, and I haven't even mentioned this yet, rest properly. A big part of what I teach is teaching clients how to rest and recover. Because in today's society, we're kind of conditioned that it's normal to be stressed out permanently and to be working our asses off till we drop, or at least till we get seriously ill, till we have no choice to stop. So most people suffer with the idea of with not being able to rest properly. So learning how to relax, learning how to breathe deeply, learning how to switch on the other part of your nervous system so that you can actually bring the body's systems into a healing state. This is also part of what I teach as well.
Right, so it's the whole lifestyle. Because some people have got this peculiar attitude, like they burn the candle at both ends. They're busy, they're working jobs that they might not be really enjoying, and then to relax, they're gonna maybe drink alcohol or do something that's not healthy just to bring them back down again. And the whole lifestyle needs looking at, doesn't it?
Not yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Every single client of mine recently, all of them have to address recovery and kind of like reducing stress. And that's just the way today's society has become.
Mm. I just want to jump topic, going back to something you said earlier about spot reducing fat. Now, for many people, the belly is a big frustrating area. It's almost like, you know, people want to get rid of that belly and it doesn't seem to want to go. And you mentioned spot reducing. So just expand on what you were talking about with that.
Oh, yes, somebody asked if they could reduce their belly fat, and you cannot spot reduce fat. In other words, if you've got fat in your belly and you want to get off your belly, you can't do loads of sit-ups to get rid of it off your belly. That's not how the body works. So what I explain to people is that your body has certain designated sites to store body fat, and there's a certain order, and it's like first place on, last place off. So if a woman stores fat on her ass or her hips, then that's going to be the first place the fat goes on, but it's also going to be the last place it comes off. So what they need to do then is start to understand the body, learn how to lose body fat as a whole, and then it will come off. But that will still be the last place it comes off. Now, the interesting thing is with the abdominal fat is that the abdominal fat has four times as many receptor sites for the stress hormone. What that basically means is that the more stressed you are, the more likely you are to never, ever lose your belly fat.
I see. Oh, so there's a direct correlation between stress, lifestyle, and belly fat.
Yeah. Simply, it was all down to hormones. I'm not going to go into the details because it'll probably get a little bit too over the head of the audience for this show. But it's, the belly fat is actually, will stay there if you're stressed.
Now, something that's really popular nowadays is high-intensity interval training and kind of CrossFit and functional fitness and things like that, you know, really popular. What's your view on all that? Do you do that kind of thing?
Well, it's quite simple. The body will adapt in the direction to which you overload it or push it. So if you look at a marathon runner, they're pushing their body to become high endurance body. Okay, now what happens when the body is starts to adapt to become highly endurance based is that it becomes highly stressed, because obviously when would you in any normal circumstance run for miles and miles and miles and miles and miles and miles and miles without any food? Well, you would only do that if it was probably a life or death situation normally. Unless it wasn't a sport. So if you look at that type of sport person, they won't have any muscle mass or very little. And again, if you have a look at a lot of these long distance runners, etc., they will have a layer of like wobbly abdominal fat.
So they'll never
be that lean. Now, then take somebody else. And the reason for that is that the body has to go a long period of time and do endurance based work on a little amount of food. So the body's going to get very, very good at surviving on a little amount of food. So it's going to do that by slowing its metabolism down. You're not going to have a long endurance runner with a fast metabolism.
Right.
So then on the opposite end of the scale, you've got like, let's say, a 100-meter sprinter. It's very short, very powerful, very explosive. So they have a lot more muscle mass. But because they get used to burning up a huge amount of energy in a very short period of time, their body gets used to turning over energy quickly. So they have fast metabolisms. And if you have a look at sprinters, they're all very lean. So they're muscular and ripped. So this goes the same for whatever you want to do. Like certain types of like CrossFit type exercises, what I call kind of a high intensity cardio, I call it, where you might do some tire flipping and some prowler pushing and some rope. Climbing, shaking, etc., and doing that in a short period of time to the point where you're on the floor panting like a dog for its life. That is seriously overloading the body's cardiovascular system. So the body's going to get fitter very quick doing that kind of work. Now, what I don't agree with is when these things are extended over long periods of time. So right. if you take something like high intensity cardio, where you do some tire flipping, prowler pushing, rope pulling, etc., and you do that and you do it in a 20-minute period and you're completely on the floor out of breath because you've done it to such a high, quick, intense burst, you've still overloaded your cardiovascular system and you're going to get fitter from that. But then if you try and do that for an hour and a half or 2 hours, you're just unnecessarily putting your body under huge amounts of stress. And again, the end result is not going to be as positive.
Right. So you're basically advocating an intense thing like that, but for a shorter period of time rather than...
Yeah. It doesn't need to be a long. Whenever you do anything for a long, long slog, the body kind of then starts to slow its metabolism down because it's kind of has to endure going a long time without food.
Yeah, I see. That makes sense. Let's talk about the macronutrient ratios, because earlier I had a guest, Laura Wilson. She's into the alkaline, the 80-10-10 kind of ratio. Are you familiar with that philosophy?
As far as I'm concerned with macronutrients, you get so many different schools of thought and on macronutrient ratios, and what I say, what I start with everybody, it all depends on your body type. Everybody has a different body type. Like you go into the real basics, people have different genetic types. It's like someone says, well, we're all human. Well, yeah, we're all human, but we're all different species of human almost. It's like there's a monkey, but then how many different species of monkey are there? They don't all eat the same. They don't all have the same genetics. They don't all have all the same metabolism. So you have to start and try and work out what your body type is. So you can, this is why you'll actually find that some people can actually thrive and do quite well on a vegetarian diet if it's healthy. Other people go on a healthy vegetarian diet and they'll be nearly dropping dead. It just doesn't suit their genetic type. It doesn't suit their body type. Everybody is very individual. I'll give you an example of this. And the digestive tract, from the mouth through the stomach all the way out to the anus, that whole length of your digestive system, that can be 100% different between an individual. So somebody could have a very long digestive tract, like an animal that eats a lot of vegetation. Or somebody could have a very short digestive tract, like an animal that eats a lot of meat. So when it comes to macronutrients, you can get lots of information and lots of studies to prove that a predominantly carbohydrate based diet will be the best for building muscle and best for your metabolism. And I've read documents and I've read articles that show that and prove that. And then you get people that do that, and all that happens is they get really fat. And they feel really sluggish and they feel really shit. But then some people will do really well on it and they feel really good. And it's simply because people have different bodies and different body types and respond differently to different types of food.
I see. What's a typical thing, just to be clear for our audience, just in case they don't know, we're talking about macronutrients, and what that means is the basic ratios of carbohydrate or protein or fats.
Yeah, your macronutrients are basically your proteins, your carbohydrates and your fats. So people have this idea that there should be a certain predominated ratio of those macronutrients. Now, those macronutrients all do different things in the body. Let me try and give you. I don't really know what else to say on that subject, to be honest.
Well, what I wanted to ask was, what's a typical meal plan for you then?
Well, I don't really do macronutrient kind of like diets as such like that. For most people, I tend to get them to learn what suits their body most and to eat what it needs when it needs it.
Okay, but how do they determine that though?
Well, what they do is they clean up their diet. They start eating more healthy foods. I start to give them recommendations on what foods to eat. Get a rough idea of their body type. So somebody that is a more carbohydrate based person, I will keep clean carbohydrates in their diet a bit more. And it depends on their goals. So obviously, if you just want to purely build muscle, but you're not too bothered about putting fat on, then you're going to be looking at your diet a bit differently to somebody that's mainly concerned about losing body fat while they're keeping muscle.
I see.
Does that make sense?
Right. So it depends on the individual goals. There's not just one answer.
It depends on the individual. I mean, it just depends on the individual, Ben.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, got it. What's coming up for you in the future? What's your plans? What's your ambitions? What are you planning to do?
At the moment, I've just sent an ebook out for test to some personal trainers, and I'm just getting some feedback on that. Just finishing that off. That's a training intensity guide. It's a bit more in depth than for the mainstream market. It's more designed for personal trainers that want to kind of improve their game, and that goes into how to take people's drive and increase it. So increase their intensity while they train, which involves a bit of psychology and also a bit of practical methods as well. So that ebook's out there at the moment. It's been finished. It's being tested. So that's going to be launched over the next couple of months. In the meantime, I'm concentrating on my client base at the moment, and I'm building up some more before and after pictures and clients. And I kind of want to move out of the area I'm in and kind of move towards Bristol Way, Clifton Way.
Ah, right. Yeah,
but before I do that, I want to finish off this bunch of clients in Western and get them all finished off so they're all up to a good standard, and then move up there with my portfolio.
Oh, excellent. So what's the plan? Like, can you talk about it, or is it like a secret plan at the moment?
There's nothing more than that, really, to be honest, Ben. It's nothing too exciting. Just move up the ladder, as it were.
Yeah. And you're going to be working with – have you got your eye on a gym you're going to be working in?
Not particularly yet. I'm going to kind of cross that bridge near at a time. It's what I found is those things kind of sort themselves out if you have the intention.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you're an intuitive kind of guy, sort of.
Completely, man, completely. Whenever you go against your intuition, you always wish you had listened to it.
Jaden, when we started this call, you said you'd just come through the door before we started talking.
Yeah.
Does that mean you haven't eaten yet?
I came through the door, and my dinner was half cooked. The greens were cooked, and I quickly cooked a steak, and I actually sat down and ate a steak while you were on the radio.
Oh, right, so you have eaten. I was starting to panic because I thought, oh, no, he's coming. He's been training all day. He probably wants to eat now.
Well, it's funny because I trained a client earlier, and I came in, and I was eating as I was walking in to train him, and I was actually eating in between training him. And he looked at me as if to say, oh, well, that's a bit unprofessional, isn't it? And I turned around to him, and I just said to him, I said, look, I said, you need to do what I do. You need to make your food a priority.
Yeah. Now, bodybuilders very often sort of eat little and often, like several small meals throughout the day. Is that right? Is that
yeah? Now, your typical bodybuilder that would go on like a high carbohydrate diet, and there's good reasons for that, and this is a big subject. They will eat sort of 5, 6, 7, sometimes more meals than that, small portions divided out through the day. So that the idea is that their body is always got a trickle in of the nutrients that it needs to kind of rebuild itself and regenerate itself. But there are different ways, different types of diets. And these days, bodybuilding has evolved, and a lot of bodybuilders are doing something called carb cycling.
Okay.
This is where you won't have any carbohydrates for 2, 3, 4, or even 5 days. And you keep your carbohydrates as low as possible, pretty much zero or as low as possible. And what that does, it gets the body used to using fat for fuel. So instead, you'll have a high-protein diet, and you'll have good quality fats in your diet. So you've got to remember, if you go back through the history of mankind, it's only in the last few thousand years that we've been an agricultural you sort of farming grains, etc. Before that, we were hunting animals, eating berries, fruits, nuts, seeds, whatever we could forage, but mainly living off of animal meat. This is where the paleo diet comes in for the vast, vast, vast majority of mankind's time on the planet. So for most body types, we'll respond quite well to a carb cycling day. This doesn't mean that you cut carbohydrates out, because carbohydrates are essential for your body. They're essential for your health. They're essential for the replacement of muscle glycogen. So it's not that it's not that they're not important and not needed. They certainly are. But if your main goal is fat loss, and your body type is right, then most people, the first thing that happens after 2 or 3 days of going on a low carb diet or zero carb diet is they all turn around to me and go, Jade, I feel really good. I feel really energized. I've got no bloating. I feel really clear, and my energy levels are just really, really stable, because your body is now using fat for fuel, as opposed to looking for the next carbohydrate feed to have its energy supply. So when your body gets used to relying on carbohydrates, it relies on carbohydrates. So when you don't have them, you get an energy dip.
I see. So that energy dip, like if you sustain the low carb for several days, then the body will switch into a fat burning mode, will it?
That's right. It will switch. And there's lots of things you can do to aid it switching into a fat burning mode, like taking certain supplements like chromium picolinate helps the body kind of utilize fat a little bit more, making sure that your food is highly nutritious. So that you've got plenty of B vitamins and plenty of vitamins, plenty of minerals, so all of its processes can work quite well. Because that's the other thing that people forget, is especially a lot of overweight people, is they're eating food that's devoid of nutrients. So they're eating processed food which doesn't have the vitamins, it doesn't have the minerals, it doesn't have the plants nutrients in it. So what the body really craves to rebuild itself are nutrients. So if you're eating food it's got hardly any nutrients in it, your body's going to say, we need to eat more of this because there's hardly any nutrients in it. So when people switch to a more healthy, nutrient-rich diet, they often find that their appetite starts to actually reduce. They don't need to eat as much.
Oh, I see. Because if they're eating nutrient-devoid food, then the body's going to carry on craving wants. And they're just carrying on putting the wrong stuff in.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, if someone came to me and they were particularly unhealthy and they wanted to train, obviously, I couldn't put them full on into a normal training program. The first thing that they should really do is go away and get some hair analysis to see what minerals they've been deficient in. Because the chances are, if they've been eating shit, they're going to be deficient in something.
Oh, I see. Oh,
and,
right.
if you're deficient in a certain mineral or a few minerals, then certain bodily processes aren't going to function properly or work as well.
Yeah, I see. Yeah. You said about the organs eating to support the organ. Is there any particular nutrients or any methods that you would use to support the health of the organs?
Well, like for instance, the liver. The liver produces something called biliary sludge, which is basically like an alkalizing fluid that comes through the liver, and it's where all the toxins are pulled through to mix with our food waste to go through the digestive tract so that we can shit it out, basically. So to produce that, you need sulfur-containing vegetables. So you need your cabbage, you need your sprouts, your garlics, your onions, etc. So it's quite simple. It's what I tell people all the time. I said, you need to go back and start eating the food that your grandparents are eating.
Yeah, because that basically, right, yeah.
So there's certain foods, like lemons are good for clearing the liver and helping that detox, etc. There are certain foods. Then you've got foods that are good for the kidneys, such as cranberries, etc., things like that. So, yeah, there's all kinds of different foods that you can eat for certain organs.
Something I noticed, and you said about this a few minutes ago, when you said people go on a low carb diet and then they start burning fat and they feel clear and they feel, you know, the bloating has gone. I really notice how my digestive system has a direct impact on my mood and emotions. If I'm feeling bloated, if I've been eating bread and I'm sort of feeling like my guts are full up, it just directly impacts my mood and emotions, my focus, and just how the way, you know, I get down if I feel bloated. And then conversely, if I feel clean, if I've been eating light food and cleansing food, and you know, I feel like everything's working as it should be, just my mood and my creativity and my mental focus, everything is much higher and better.
Oh yeah. This goes back to what I was saying at the beginning about making your body function on a more high optimum level. Your food that you eat affects the hormones that you produce as well, so your hormones affect your thinking too. And obviously if you put shit in your body, it's gonna create shit thinking.
Yeah. When you're talking about a high protein kind of diet and low carbs, is that similar to how the Atkins diet works?
Well, the Atkins diet doesn't really have any carbs in it at all, which especially if you're physical and you're training, you need the carbohydrates. But all you do is you're timing your nutrients, your macronutrients. So for 2, 3, 4, 5 days, you're not really having many carbs, and then one day you'll eat quite a lot of carbs, so you'll carb up. And what this does in the body, it kind of like I said as well, if you push your body in one direction, it kind of rebounds in the other. So when you reduce the carbohydrates or lower them down, the muscles become a lot more sensitive to carbohydrates, so that when you do eat them, they can uptake those carbohydrates into the muscle more.
Right. Is that only relevant for someone that's been exercising and depleting the glycogen stores in the muscle?
Yeah, for your average office worker that's not really doing much apart from walking around, then their need for glycogen replacement is going to be really low.
Right, so that's why, like, a physically active person, like a bodybuilder, is going to be able to eat a lot more carbs without getting fat, because they're going to be replenishing the depleted muscle glycogen.
And the more muscle they've got and the harder they train, the more they're going to need.
Right. Yeah, because I was watching this Cali Muscle video. For people that don't know him, he's like a big bodybuilder from America. He does a lot of YouTube videos. And he was doing a video diary of the night before a bodybuilding competition. And he was just eating as much as he could. He just had plates and plates of food, loads of carbs, loads of dessert, just everything. And what's the reason for that?
Again, that's to manipulate hormones. He's going to increase insulin, which is going to uptake nutrients into the muscle. It's a very anabolic hormone, as well as, you know, insulin can be bad for fat loss as well. But because he had carb depleted, he needed to get those nutrients into his muscles as quickly as possible. So that's what would have happened. Also, other hormones are affected, like leptin. Sometimes when you have a really big feed in, when you're really hungry and you really need it, if you starve yourself and you go against feeding yourself when you need to, your leptin levels will drop down. Leptin comes from the Greek word meaning thin. So when your leptin levels are high, your metabolism is running fast. When your leptin levels are low, your metabolism slows down.
Right. And this brings us on an important topic, which is to not starve yourself, which is the mistake a lot of people make.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, you push your body in that direction, your metabolism will slow down. Look at somebody that goes on a calorie-restricted diet, like Weight Watchers, etc. They have an 80% return rate from their customers. In other words, you see them all the time. They go on this diet, they lose weight, and then they have a rebound, and they put it back on quicker than they did before and more than they did before, and then they go back on the calorie restriction. I've seen it. It's like yo-yo dieters. Mm-hmm. And really, really, they don't need to do that. They can just be a bit more intelligent with it and kind of cycle things in a miniature way, so that they lose a bit of fat, then they have a refeed, gets their metabolism running faster again, then reduce things, then refeed.
Yeah. Is it for that carb cycle like you're describing, where you go low carbs and then have a feed, is a weekly cycle a good amount of time? Like you go low carbs in the week and then maybe eat more cheat meals on the weekend? Does that work?
It will depend on the person. It depends on what they're doing in the gym, on their lifestyle, etc. It depends on their body type, etc. So it all depends, man. It's so individualized.
Okay, right. I remember Kane saying to me once that, just as a very simple analogy, the idea is, if you want to get in shape, lose body fat, the idea is to stoke up the metabolism like a furnace, almost so you can be eating more food and still be burning more fat.
Yeah. I mean, there's a really interesting bodybuilder who's won the natural Mr. Olympia, which is no one ever hears of it. It's not really, no one really knows about it because it's not really as well publicised because it's for natural bodybuilders. But this guy looks amazing. Now, he eats about anywhere from 5,000 to 7,000 calories a day in the last few weeks running up to his show.
Right, that's a lot.
That's a lot of calories. Yeah. That's like 3 to 4 times what the average person would eat.
Right. And that's because he's doing so much exercise, so much weightlifting. His metabolism's so high that it basically just needs all that amount of energy.
Yeah. Your metabolism is related to your muscle mass. The more muscle you got, the faster your metabolism is going to go.
Right. So the muscles are like fat-burning assets.
Oh, yeah. But there are motor units. If you think about it in terms of like movement and energy expenditure, there are engine of our body. That's what moves us around.
So this is why weightlifting is so effective for burning fat, because it's going to be increasing the muscle mass. That's going to end up burning more energy and help with the fat loss.
That's right. I mean, our brain burns energy because it requires energy to function, and our organs burn a certain amount of energy, but nothing compared to our muscular system.
I see. Something I've noticed, because I've experimented with the low carb for several days, and I notice my mental focus, I get a bit delirious, and my emotions can become a bit unstable. And you told me about this before, but tell our audience.
When you've done low carb?
Yeah.
Now looking at your body type, you would not be suited to a long-term low-carb diet, I would not think, because you're quite lean and you started off as an ectomorph quite skinny.
Right.
So you wouldn't need to kind of like drop your carbs quite so much as, say, somebody that was more obese when they started.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, but that can also be down to other reasons, maybe not having enough good quality fats, maybe not getting enough food in general. Also could be due to your body adjusting.
Yeah.
Maybe you didn't take chromium picolinate to get your insulin levels up, which is a trace mineral that we should have in our body, but we don't because of our lack of nutrients in food.
Yeah, no, I didn't take that. I've never bought that one yet.
Oh, mate, it makes such a huge difference. Yeah, it's a trace mineral that should be in our bodies but isn't anymore because you get it in the soil, and obviously our food that we eat doesn't come from proper organic soil.
Is that just relevant for people that are doing weightlifting, or can anyone take that supplement and it will improve their fat?
I wouldn't recommend it to somebody unless they were low carb. I mean, you often find it in a lot of fat-burning tablets as well for that reason.
I see. You wouldn't. I don't quite understand. Why wouldn't you recommend it to someone unless they were low carbon?
If somebody's eating a crappy diet where they're eating refined food and their insulin levels are being spiked by eating white bread, pastries, pasties, cakes, sugars, all these things that are going to spike your insulin, then what chromium picolinate does, it helps regulate your blood sugar levels and helps regulate like the blood sugar in the body. So it's going to make that more efficient. But if it's already been like stressed through high insulin spikes throughout the day, then all you're going to do in the long run is kind of stress it a little bit more, because you want to use it to make your blood sugar system become more efficient when you're used to not having carbs.
It's more relevant during the low carb philosophy.
Yeah.
I see. I got it. Jada, we're starting to come to the end of the show, and you've actually done a much longer spot than I was anticipating, because I was going to go on with Nathan a little bit longer, and he dropped off the call. So I want to thank you for speaking so long.
No props. It's easy.
Yeah. Why is it easy, Jada? Tell us.
Well, I can talk about this stuff all day long. In fact, I do.
Yeah.
Well, I'm quite passionate about it, to be honest.
Yeah, and it doesn't feel like work when you're doing something you enjoy, does it?
Definitely not. No, it doesn't. It definitely doesn't.
Yeah, so jadacastellari.com. I don't know if Vin's going to put that on the People's Internet Radio website. So it's J-A-D-A.
Yeah.
C-A-S. Go on, you do it.
C-A-S-T-E-L-L-A-R-I.
Okay, so there's much more. There's free resources. There's videos that me and Jade have done in the past talking more specifically about specific topics, which are quite useful for people. We talked about weightlifting techniques, and that's very informative for a lot of people. I get a lot of great feedback over our videos.
Yeah, I do. I always get loads of positive feedback from our videos.
Yeah.
I think we're giving away too much for free, Ben. That's the problem.
Yeah. That's because my value on becoming famous is higher than my value on making money.
That's right. Yeah, and that determines your behaviours.
Yeah, it's true though, isn't it?
Yeah.
There's no need to rush off. We got it's 10 to, we've got a few more minutes left. Recently, over the last couple of months, I don't know if you've noticed, and I'm going to tell the listeners about my own stuff, my own website. So I've got benlarry.com, and what I've started to do, I've just using that website for stuff that's related to fitness, the things that me and Jade had just been talking about, stuff to do with weightlifting, stuff to do with bodybuilding, body transformation stuff. So people can go there, benlarry.com, so benlowrey.com. Also, what I decided to do, Jada, is niche all my separate topics onto separate websites. So I built a separate website for positive, inspirational type of stuff. I called it claritytothrive.com. Cool. And that's just more about positive living, health, wealth, happiness, anything to do with that. I did an interview a couple of weeks ago with a woman who's a property investor. She's built up a portfolio of properties, and she was explaining the strategy that she uses, you know, the way she does the mortgages, and you know, how she finds properties that are sort of undervalued or really good value. And she talked about that, and I put that interview on claritytothrive.com. Also got some nutritional interviews on there. And that's like an ongoing kind of internet radio show that I'm going to be doing on an ongoing basis. Also, it's not particularly relevant to this conversation at all, but over the last few years, I started having more fun. I started getting involved with circus skills, you know, like stilt walking, fire spinning, handstands, acrobatics, stuff like that, and actually started making money from it as well, doing gigs. You know, you can get paid reasonably well to do those kind of performance things. And also working at hen parties, doing buff butler. Because since I've been going to the gym, I've been putting on a bit of muscle. You can get paid a reasonable amount of money to pour champagnes wearing a bow tie and an apron to groups of women that are having hen parties. It's a tough life. It's a tough job, but somebody's got to do it.
I know it sounds ironic and we've a bit cliche and we've all heard it before, but really what each individual should be doing is living in their highest excitement and just living their passion, and no matter what they feel it is, that's what everybody needs to be doing is living like that. And as bizarre as it sounds, very often we all have talents and skills that are so natural to us but we don't value them, so we don't think anything of them, and so we don't think that, oh, we could actually make money out of that, we could actually make a living doing what we love, because it's effortless and it's easy, and we're so conditioned to believe that our work should be hard.
Yeah,
in fact it's called hard work. Do a decent day's hard work.
Yeah, I've never understood that. I've never understood why people want to work hard. I've always been more focused on getting the results.
I say work passionately.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And I just want to mention one more website because it's relevant to what you just said. Passive income. You know, I was a guitarist. Jada knows this. I don't know if the audience do. I used to be a guitarist. I built an online guitar lesson website. And I put video guitar lessons on the website. And then people could just pay on PayPal and they could download them. And the great thing about this is it created a passive income because people just buy stuff from the website. Whether you're asleep, no matter what you're doing, you know, you only have to create an online product once. And like Jada just said, everybody's got skills. People underestimate themselves. People undervalue, you know, the abilities. Because if you think about it, we all go through life and we accumulate certain expertise, certain knowledge about stuff. And really, anybody can build a business based around the things that they enjoy doing, based around the things they're knowledgeable about. And I've been proof of that, doing the guitar lesson website and doing the other things I've done. I've never had a job. I've never been on income support, never been on the dole, never been a drug dealer, never had handouts from my parents, nothing. I've supported myself with passive income just doing these internet projects, you know. And I decided to build a website that teaches people how to do that as well. It's called ultimatepassiveincometraining.com, and it's just got a few, you know, there's some audio things on there from me explaining some of the philosophies, how to build the website, how to put products online. It just gives you, you know, it doesn't give you all the answers, but it just points you in the right direction, and it helps you just come up with the ideas of it helps stimulate your thoughts and stimulate your creativity to think of, you know, to help anybody think of ways of creating those kind of businesses, those kind of income streams. So I wanted to mention that just before we wrap up, because it is really good, it is really valuable. And if anybody wants to contact me, benlowry@me.com. That's benlowry@me.com. JD, we're going to wrap up now. I want to thank you for coming on the show.
Cheers.
Yeah, no, it's props. Really good. Yeah, if anybody wants to get in contact, you go to the website, jdcastellari.com. And I want to thank Vin for having me on the show. I want to thank Fiona. You're listening to peoplesinternetradio.com. Be sure to log on and check out the archive shows as well. You know, this past editions of the show are all logged on the website. Vin's doing a great job, really a positive force for good in the world. He's got a whole range of different topics on this show that's very inspirational, very informative. And so we all appreciate Vin for doing that. Vin, have we got the music lined up, ready to finish the show? Should be coming in now. So thank you, everybody. Thanks for listening. And Fiona will be back next month, the first Tuesday of the month, for her regular Back to Health show. And she'll have some more guests on then.
Back to Health Radio is delighted to be sponsored by The Really Healthy Company. www.healthy.co.uk